good morning. I hope to connect where we paused yesterday. So yesterday we stopped at what are the tools for preventive environmental management, and we essentially said that some of those tools are so well tried and well understood today that they in fact have a place in the plethora of environmental governance, and more specifically in the regulations of this country. I am just taking this discussion further by saying that one thing is tools, which I have identified four categorical tools. And what are the tools? They are more fundamental. It revolves around a more concrete encapsulated idea, and there is a kind of protocol available how to go about doing it in the best manner. And the whole idea in governance is that not only you do good job, but you also make sure that when somebody else does the job, you try to understand it and compare and contrast with your results and your impressions. So that entire exercise is a part of, integral part of monitoring and analyzing and governing. So therefore, codification of the process and the common minimum agenda for the activity, and finally the protocol development has been done on all these four things that you are seeing on the view graph here. Well, now we take the application of tools further, that you apply a tool around a question, and that specific questions are termed here as interventions. That nobody applies a given technique for nothing. If there is a fracture, then you will think of going for some kind of X-ray or some other technique by which you can see what is the damage inside. So you have to have a question, you have to have a reason to go into deeper discussion. And that is what essentially we are looking at what are the possible ways in which you can raise logical questions in connection with the preventive management, preventive environmental management more specifically. So obviously the first of all can be identification of potential intervention. That what can I really do? What are my possibilities? What could be my menu card? You know, that kind of discussion is the first exercise, which is a very deliberate thinking exercise, which hopefully will give you possibilities and planning around those possibilities, or combining few possibilities together to convert into a more well-directed monitoring or assessment program. Second is obviously greener chemistry and processes, and obviously those remaining things which I am going to tell you will be appearing on the map of potential interventions. And then you say that way, in this particular process I need to look at the chemical options, and am I really greener, how do I become more green, that question you are asking. So basically tinkering with the process, that is first thing. Then second thing is the chemical technology, tinkering with the technology. The third thing is greener choices in process industry. That should I really convert, transform, modify, do upscaling of a given sector, and what are the choices of those process industries. Now, redesigning unit operations and unit processes within that particular process industry, can I reformulate, can I reorganize the process so that environmental costs and environmental implications are going to be manageable, and therefore you redesign the unit operations and unit processes. So either you play with the chemistry, you play with the technology, you play with the choice of the industry so that you do hierarchy and prioritization of hierarchy assessment and prioritization of the sectors, or finally you also try to talk about how do I get into newer processes and newer unit operations or different unit operations by which I can make the production industry more eco-friendly. It is recognized all over the world that any production consumption activity will have environmental footprint, ecological footprint. So the entire effort is that A, not do it, or B, try to minimize the impact. There are the two basic elements. The preventive environmental management actually starts the discussion on possibilities by not doing it, or then doing it less and then eliminating the damage altogether, or at least part of it as much as possible, through ingenious innovative application of management techniques and technology, and so to speak science and technology knowledge. Obviously the sixth listed here is recycle and reuse of wastewater, And why am I saying wastewater? You could even say solvent, you could even say metal, scrap metal, you could say so many things here. But I am specifically listing it as a specific intervention, that recycle and reuse of wastewater, because I do not know any place in the world which can claim that it has surplus water. In fact, only places where there are very few human beings, one can argue that, so man to land ratio, if the land is far more than the number of persons there, and even the nature is more supportive, that it is not a desert, it is a normal ecosystem, then probably water may not be limiting. But most of the places in the world, if you consider 7 billion people in the world, one can safely say that 5 billion people for sure are subjected to water shortages throughout the year, or at least during the major part of the year they face the water shortages. So recycle and reuse of wastewater not only is a part of the academic discourse, but you should not be surprised that even United Nations Environment Program is peddling it as one of the most important interventions that we should use science, technology, enterprise to work for. The seventh is sustainable and intelligent consumption. Why am I putting it at a seventh level? Because above these, from 2 to 6, you obviously were talking about how does the manufacturer of the goods or services should approach the question of sustainability and making the process environmentally sustainable. But really, anybody is manufacturing today in the marketplace because consumers are consuming. So the agenda of how to manufacture will be ultimately governed, will be ultimately influenced largely by the public at large, by the community, which is going to essentially consume the products. If the production services are not required by the community, no industry will go forward to manufacture it or offer those services. Therefore, sustainable and intelligent consumption is the crux of matter. Don't forget that. So that is a very important intervention that we need to do at a community level. And not only laws are going to help, but also voluntary actions of the community, and awareness and participation and willingness to walk extra mile. These are the important programs that different communities and regulatory agencies are implementing throughout the world today. For example, industries on their own want to become more eco-friendly nowadays because they see that the acceptance by the aware community will be more if their products are taken care. So extended producer responsibility is another level of voluntary program which many organizations today, commercial organizations today implement. It may be taking back the tin and can of pesticide. It may be taking back the used tires. It may be taking back the scrap metal from the people after utilization of a given equipment or consumer durable machine. Or it may be simply taking away, as simple as that, soft drink can or the water bottle, taking it back. The consumer connects to the manufacturer in a more dear way if you really initiate the extended producer responsibility type of intervention from the manufacturer, or all mobile manufacturers come together and do a particular thing. All laptop manufacturers or tablet manufacturers come together and do a particular thing. Or the entire paper industry decides that 25% of the pulp will be made from scrap paper or the newsprint. Or entire packaging industry decides that each and every packaging material, every carton will be recycled at least 3 times. Or same thing can be done by the packaging industry with respect to different polymers, HDP, LDP, PVC, PET and what have you. Same thing about containers of liquids and drinking water and medicines, and they also do the same thing. So that is one activity which is extended producer responsibility. Last 10-15 years I am observing that many corporations and the product professional organizations around a particular product like paper, plastic, this, that, packaging, they are coming together, and although they are competing with each other on the front of product and market share, but they are with each other and collaborate with each other finding the solution. And that solution finding process nowadays, therefore, is done in an eco-industrial networking fashion, that all paracetamol manufacturers of the country will come together and they will go for a cheaper, cleaner way of making paracetamol. All the fine chemicals, the active ingredients of medicines, all the bulk organic chemicals, or all the people who food processing people or thermal power stations or captive power plants. I can go and there's so many examples where you can have the eco-industrial network that 50, 100, 200 diester manufacturers in a given industrial estate will hire a group of consultants, a group of institutions, and then they will say that we will take all our problems to them, and then if a solution is given, everybody in that consortium is free to use that solution. So eco-industrial networking. So you network on the level of need for infusing new science and technology to solve your environmental problem so that conscientiously you can make the sector greener. And then finally, integrated policy making. So making changes at science technology level, making changes at production routine level, making changes at management level, making changes in the hardware of the company level, or making changes in internal relationship between the consumer versus manufacturer or manufacturer versus manufacturer. These could be bag of tricks, bag of interventions that the manufacturers and consumers can implement. There may be certain interventions which are mandatory and certain interventions are voluntary. And in fact, the world is moving now from mandatory to voluntary type of efforts. Somebody has asked me a question. SVU College of Engineering, Tirupati, Chittur, from Andhra Pradesh. And the question is, what are the specific programs of government that are involved in control of water pollution? I think it's a very good and very broad question. There are many things that government or regulatory agencies, State Pollution Control Board, in your case, Andhra Pradesh has Andhra Pradesh Pollution Control Board, and obviously they work in conjunction with Central Pollution Control Board, and both the institutions work under the leadership of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and also the State Department of Environment and Forests. So this at a state level, at Andhra Pradesh level, they would have their own administration, and at Central Delhi level, we have a central administration, and they work together, and that is how they address the problem of water pollution. Now, they are not only looking at wastewater, they are not looking at only drinking water, but as I explained to you yesterday, both things are addressed together. So drinking water quality is monitored by like maybe local self-government, a municipality, or the food related administration, but the wastewater will be managed by industrial estate in a common effluent treatment plant, CETP, or individual industry will be asked to do the own treatment. If the medium scale industry or a large scale industry, they will be asked to have their own treatment plant, and small scale, cottage scale industries will have the cooperative efforts of treating the wastewater, which is called a CETP program. And there are, if my numbers are right, something on the order of 70 CETPs all over the country. Maharashtra itself, I think, have about 25 CETPs. Gujarat itself probably has 25, 30, 35 CETPs as of today. And the rest of the country, I'm sure, would have many CETPs. So maybe 75 CETPs all over the country, and which is each CETP catering to a cluster of industry. For example, in Maharashtra, Maharashtra Industrial Development Corporation, MIDC, takes responsibility of providing such a cooperative facility to the industries in the given industrial area are the members, and then they are asked by legal force to send their wastewater with a minimum pretreatment so that, you know, pH excursions and too much of toxicity and too much of gases effervescence from emerging from the wastewater will not affect the public life and the people who are managing the CETP facility around them, and also there will not be corrosion of pipeline network and gutters and what have you. So all that care will be taken, and with minimum pretreatment, they will send all the waste to a combined facility, and there it will be treated by mixing together, and one very detailed wastewater treatment is given. This is a program which is very aggressively pursued by all states and by central government. You have similar efforts now, although in my opinion, this is my personal opinion, that we are very weak in treatment of our sewages which are emerging from communities. Those communities now are motivated, and the credit line is made available to them, and through the Jawaharlal Nehru Urban Renewal Mission, government was giving support to dozens of cities, and now our honorable Prime Minister of our country has announced that there will be more than 100 smart cities in the country. And one of the tenets, one of the properties characters of smart cities would be that their solid waste, that their air pollution, that their liquid waste treatment, and also the industrial waste treatment will be done in a very upscaled manner, in a very responsible manner, and some of the exemplary treatment will be given in those cities, and there will be excellent monitoring and incorporation of community and NGOs and the CBOs, community-based organizations, and non-government organizations. Some of the very active individual citizens will be part of the monitoring network that will be created for evaluating the progress, success and progress of the utilities and the environmental infrastructure. So there are many ways in which the government is pushing a regulatory agenda, and to enable that regulatory agenda, we have been for at least last 2-3 decades, we have made concerted efforts in putting more and more money in it. Now, one can argue that probably the money put in for this activity is not adequate, and therefore we are still in 5-10-20% kind of success in terms of the magnitude of the problem. And this opinion has a place in the discussion. But nevertheless, it's important to understand that government is making efforts to put in more money and do it more. And it is a commonly understood or commonly accepted stand that government has to do far more than what it has done so far. So in that sense, we have to be looking forward in a very positive frame of mind. But should I mention it once again that regulatory agenda is not the only agenda which will save our environment, which is understood even by government. Therefore, lot of encouragement is there for the voluntary agenda. That what can you do as a community on your own? What can you do as an industry on your own? What can you do as an industrial estate on your own? Or what can you do as a sector on your own? So all these sector-based organizations and the industrial estates and the administration which is responsible for bringing industrialization of the country is encouraged to also become active partner in protection of environment. And it is not only for water, the question is for water, it's a good question, but I am taking time to answer this question because exactly same effort is done in solid waste management, same effort is done in hazardous waste management, there is a common regional facility to take care of that, same effort is done on the air pollution activity, and all over the country, some of the important cities pollution, for example, my colleague Professor Viren Sethi has done the last 12-13 years of work is only on different cities, for example. And how do we really see it as a group activity, as a cluster problem, and our airshed should be studied, and not only a one tailpipe or one chimney, but entire airshed is studied, or entire industrial estate is addressed. These kind of things are done by people who are protecting us from air pollution. So two things. One is by act of law that you are putting certain regulations and restrictions, and then you are monitoring it more vigilantly, more routinely, more frequently. And second thing is that you are encouraging community, encouraging industry, encouraging municipality to get into more voluntary mode of action, so that the money spent on regulation, governance is well spent, that we are not spending time in creating a police state, but we are creating a society which is more democratically oriented, and we are hoping that their best senses and do it. Which essentially also answers another question that is put by Pavai Engineering College, Namakkal in Tamil Nadu. Basically, the question is that if we protect river, sir, then we give police force. Basically saying that to protect, for example, dredging and loss of biodiversity in a riverbed, we should use police force and stop sand dredging. Good point. Sand dredging is a very good point that is flagged in this question. So sand dredging part I really like and I support. In Maharashtra state, we have a banning of almost 95% of the places where sand dredging was, river sand dredging was done. And there is a policy and regulation in place in state of Maharashtra for riverbeds in Maharashtra. But at the same time, we should not overdo utilizing police force for this activity. Then you are eliminating the role and enthusiasm and significance of civil society and community and voluntary actions of individuals. See, we individually, one is very big number actually. If we don't do right thing in our sphere, if I do the same thing which you do, which everybody else does, then society automatically becomes cleaner, better, more sustainable, more environmentally relevant. So it is not that, you know, something can be better done through police. In fact, my mind tells me that what if you do it something from bottom of your heart, which actually is going to give bear more sweet fruits and better results will be obtained if we do it on our own before anybody does some dandagiri, you know, somebody forces us to do this, otherwise I will hit you with the stick of law, with the stick of regulation. I think people, then if the moment you try to utilize this as a force, then there will be a counter action, because human beings' minds have so much of inertia that for every action there is equal and opposite reaction. So that Newton's law is also applicable to our inertia, and obviously then we try to react like that. So the best thing is to motivate people, educate people, and then, you know, bring them into the partnership with the government, with the regulatory agency, and sort of have a public-private partnership, not only in investment and operating a business, but also following and taking forward every civic enterprise. That is what people have realized, and a lot of efforts are actually in that direction. So the quick question that probably somebody might have is that how do we enable preventive environmental management? And obviously conservation is one of the things that we need to talk about. And the second thing is source reduction, which is a major thing for any municipality, any industry. You have to do that. And then obviously you have to keep in mind that preventive environmental management is a process and it is not an event. You can't do it, let us do for coming 15 days, coming 1 month, we'll invest our energy in doing preventive management, and then, you know, for rest of our life we'll be all right. That is not the case. It is not a silver bullet, and we will have to try again and again. And everybody's idea, right from foreman, right from worker to the managing director of the company, same thing, right from a sweeper to the commissioner of municipal corporation, everybody's ideas are important, and we have to have an inclusive approach, and we have to have a, you know, let everybody subscribe to the larger objective. I think that will essentially take us to more preventive future rather than on spending money on only the curative approach, that is cleaning and paying for regulation and paying for monitoring. Well, now that brings us to a slightly larger platform, that is how this civil society, how regulatory agencies, how the governance process is actually creating new laws and regulations in this country. So it is not that only experts and some professors or some subject experts or somebody is only creating laws and regulations in this country. But even society, civil society, the people who are close to ground, the people who have grievances about how they are going about doing certain things, even they are helping directly and indirectly in creating newer structures, newer frameworks for regulation. How are these things done is a very interesting thing to pay attention to. It is generally agreed now that the polluter pays. If I say it today that polluter pays, I am sure anybody in primary school and anybody at a very highest level in the community will accept that yes, yes, polluter must pay. You won't believe 20 years back, people were fighting and going to court arguing against it. But now, last 10, 20, 25 years in The Hague, in the international courts, in the many developmental agencies and international agencies like WHO, like IMF or the World Bank, or in our case which we deal with many times, Asian Development Bank, or any developmental international agency, or the international groups such as United Nations Environment Program, all of those are saying that polluters should pay, and it is now part of nearly all the countries in the world, that is a part of the regulatory framework that polluter must pay. Now, that is where actually pinning down the responsibility of a polluter with the consequences and therefore help pay and clean up. Many legal provisions insist today that pay me now and argue later. Now, when the moment you say the polluter must pay, the moment you make a rule or whether you make an assertion, somebody will say, I am not a polluter, I am not only responsible. Yes, I am one of those, but another 100 people are also responsible. So this kind of discussion will start. So therefore, the regulatory agency can say that fine, good, good, good. Prima facie, we feel that these few number of people or industries or communities are responsible for this pollution. We are going to recover cost of cleanup from these people. Then you still have right to go to court, and the natural law will be delivered through the court system. And then when it is proven that not only you two, but 10 other people are responsible equally, then your money will be returned and other people will be charged at the cost of cleanup. But today, you pay me now and then let us argue later. And we will listen to your argument. And it is the moment you pay, it doesn't mean that it is only, it is sticking to you. It will not stick to you, and courts say it should stick to you. So the people cannot simply take the courts for ride and use the court system as a delay tactic. That is the whole idea. Absolute and vicarious liability are two different concepts which are used in environmental management, where people are individually responsible, absolutely, and they are jointly also responsible. These are the two things that are present. So an individual official from an industry can be held responsible. All the officials of industry, including managing director of the industry, can be held jointly responsible, or all the member industries of the sector can be held jointly responsible if they are not really trying to do right kind of things. So another effort, that is the governance agencies are saying that you clean up the pollution and then go to the ambient environment, open reality, open system, in a better level of cleanup than what you really started with. So I'll just give you a case in point. Suppose I am extracting water from river for my industry. Now I would like to put back that water after treatment through my process industry back into the river. So I take from river, I put back into river. Now this is a very good idea, and nobody can, law certainly support that. The only condition nowadays some people are putting, some communities have put, is that you can take the water from river, but when you return water to river after your use, that water quality should be better than what you took. So the background quality will be improved as you proceed. And the state of Oregon in United States started this particular activity, and within 6 years they saw that their rivers were cleaner. And now so many other states in the United States followed the suit, and they also started insisting the same thing. So there are many creative modifications in governance are done, because of which even the larger systems will get better quality of water, better quality of environment in the years to come. Another strategy that people are using nowadays is that negotiable environmental standard. This is the worldwide scanning that I am presenting to you. It is not only what we do in India, but most of the things, in fact, what I am telling you are not done in India, but these are worth learning, and I can assure you, if not tomorrow, in pretty soon, some of these things will start coming into our country. Already there is a mood, already there are certain efforts, limited experiments are going on. For example, negotiable environmental standards, that a community is known for polluting nearby river or nearby coast by putting their partially treated or imperfectly treated wastewater into the water body. Now, the regulatory agency sits across the community and says that we are very unhappy that you are violating the law for so many years, so many months, whatever. And how can we help you in doing the better job? They say that we will need so many crore rupees of investment, but we can't do it until there is a guarantee that it will be appreciated by the government and there will be some kind of benefits coming to us. And I can tell you, there have been examples and case studies of the communities, that the community which was in violation for 6 years went ahead and created a water with 3 BOD, my friends. They were not able to meet 30 BOD. But they created a water of 3 BOD, and then that water could be given for industries, for industrial application. And very high quality water it was. So after disinfection, they even allowed it to put into ground and raise the level of groundwater. The community which was not capable of treating their wastewater because of their financial problems, the community finally was able to sell the higher quality water to the state government. And then that actually gave a solution to the water shortages in the community by application of right kind of technology. And that viability funding was given by the governance system so that they could actually implement a higher level of technology. So if you negotiate, it's not necessary that you always insist that 30 milligram BOD should be our final objective. Some people are capable of giving you 3, but then that viability gap funding, that kind of, you know, teething trouble, that support, that kind of handholding is required from the side of the regulator. So the regulator's job is not to only show that your standard stipulated to you was so much and I wanted you to do 30, but you are giving me 31, therefore you are a violation. Then soon people will say, if it is 30 and then 31 is violation, then okay, then I'll do 100, 100 also is violation. So why would I really exert and try to do better and better? Earlier I was 100, now I am trying to do 50. I am 50, I can do 10. I am 10, I can do 3. But you know, you should give me the opportunity, appreciate me, and become my partner in this particular journey. So negotiable environmental standards is a, most of the advanced countries have negotiable standards, that they know what is minimum required and then beyond that, negotiable standards are there. There is one question, this connects me to a question that is, somebody is asking me about, we set a minimum standard for these industry and categorize them according to their fulfillment of the criteria. Silicon Institute of Technology, Bhuvaneshwar from Orissa, this was the question. Yeah, I think it's a very good addition in the discussion. There is something called as minimum national standards, which are stipulated under the Water Act, the Prevention and Control of Water Pollution Act of 1974. And there are sector by sector minimum standards, overall the ambient water, river water, lake water standards, and depending on receiving body of water you are discussing, depending on that they are asking for different standards. So minimum standards are stipulated in this country. Obviously standards is a moving thing. Today you have certain standard, after more in the understanding of science and technology, after industry representatives say about the practicality of that standard or success, or if everybody, the table has now been raised to a particular level where we are doing better, then can we do even further? Like earlier we were talking about 30 milligram BOD, 100 milligram COD, 100 milligram for suspended matter as a treated water standard for sewages or cell waste water. Then slowly we added to that the so much of bioassay, that if we put so many number of fish, then the fish will survive with whatever 95 percentile performance over a period of whatever 96 hours. So we are seeing that not only that water should be clean as per the milligram concentration of the pollutant, but also it should be biologically acceptable in a natural aquatic environment. So bioassay was considered as one of the important additions. Now today we are even talking about making it 10. So 30 milligram BOD will now become 10 milligram BOD as we progress, and as we see that 30 is very definitely achievable, and now our objective has to be slightly higher and we can even do better than 30. So let us aim at 10. So government on its own, regulatory bodies on their own, community on its own will accept this kind of progress, and this in, I would consider definitely as a progress in right direction, and that will happen. It is also now started in India and I'm sure it will continue to happen at many places. But that minimum national standard is definitely a very important line, and one should not see that line as the ultimate line, but we should see that as a minimum line, that if nothing, that's the minimum performance that you are supposed to give. If you do better than that, in fact, you are expected to do better than that. Should I remind it second time, remind you that about the amendments to India's constitution, that protection and improvement, these are the two elements embedded into amended constitution clauses with respect to environment. So we were talking about negotiable environment standards. We can also talk about market-based tools and permits. For example, clean development mechanism, if you must have heard, carbon credits, you must have heard about it, or some of the cess and taxes, which if you do a certain type of behavior, then certain taxes will not be applicable to you. So incentives and penalties, that if you do so much, then in fact your certain amount of tax will go down. If you invest so much of money, 120% can be written off from your taxable income, because you are putting for R&D, you are putting for quality assurance, you are also putting for environmental protection, you are putting a laboratory. So you are taking a knowledge-based approach, science-based approach, you are taking a methodical approach, therefore we allow you to pay lesser taxes, or depreciation can be claimed, 100% depreciation can be claimed in first year itself, which actually that was one idea of practice about 10-15 years ago, and that really gave some benefit to the industries. There was a tax break, and as a result they tried to invest more money in environment related R&D and monitoring, and that increased the performance of or investment into pollution treatment technologies. So they went from routine, conventional, minimum technologies to slightly more advanced technologies. Many international trade treaties and accords also are talking about environment. NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, or you know, Dunkel proposition olden days, or you can see any type of environmental trade related negotiation. Environment can be used as a encouraging platform, or it can be used as a platform for punishment, that there can be embargo because of poor environmental performance. There can be ban on imports because of the violation of environmental and ecological expectations. Or there can be encouragement, or there can be more favored treatment just because you have a particular environmental and performance related certification, then you are considered as a better supplier than anybody else. Or there is a minimum cutoff of performance below which the suppliers will not be allowed to take part into the tendering process for supply of these goods and services. So there are many ways in which we have made efforts to bring new laws and new regulations with the help of civil society, with the help of regulators, and a continuous dialogue between them. There is yet another thing which is called as public interest litigation and activism of judiciary, which also is actually encouraging people to go for newer frameworks and newer laws, and new concepts are emerging. Public interest litigation is an important feature of India's legal framework and judicial program. Not too many countries in the world have this kind of provision which we have. I'll just quickly, a lot can be said about what is a public interest litigation versus any other litigation. But typically, those of you who are probably more familiar with what is a law and what is the basic framework of a law, you would know that usually all the laws that you know, laws of torts, that A is affected because of B's performance, B's behavior, B's actions. Therefore, A proceeds against B, and if it is established, B is punished, or many times B is asked to pay for the damage of A. So that way the damage creator pays, something similar to polluter pays. So again, so all are the laws of tort. That cause-effect relationship are established, agencies are pinned down, identified, who are responsible for doing that kind of thing, and then based on that you are asking the agency which is on wrong side to pay for the damages. So, which are the laws of tort? But not quite, that is not the best way of protecting environment. There has to be slightly broader, larger, more benevolent, more forward-looking philosophical provision should be available for protection of environment. For example, I am sitting in Mumbai, and based on my environmental knowledge and based on my concern for India's monuments, I can say that vehicular pollution is probably affecting all the important heritage structures of India. Or I can say that vehicular pollution is affecting the iron rods in the concrete, and they are getting more corroded because of the air pollution. And as a result, the life of concrete is going down. As a result, there is a huge national loss because the constructions are not lasting more than, say, 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, whatever you would like to say, based on scientific analysis. And I wish that we control air pollution so that all the structures will go longer and there will not be this huge national loss can be stopped. Or there is more incidence of cancer or asthma or bronchial disease or gastrointestinal disease because of dirty water. And you can apply this principle to anything. I can say that I think that there are XYZ refineries and so many number of cars in the vicinity of Taj Mahal, and Taj Mahal is becoming yellow, and the marble is getting corroded because of the air pollution around it. So I think something should be done and that pollution should be stopped. Then the court will take this request knowing very well that a person sitting in Mumbai is not directly the beneficiary or loser if corrosion or pollution in Taj Mahal is stopped or not stopped. But out of the public interest, out of a larger benevolent interest, that person is raising this point and seeking for the judicial help. So this is called as public interest litigation, that you are not fighting for your benefit, but you are fighting at large for the benefit of animals, birds, ecosystem, nature, environment, people at large, other communities, those kinds of things. So these are called as public interest litigation. And whether we like it or not, the fact is that some of the best public interest litigations have brought newer legislation and newer framework and generated new concept for environment and resource management in this country. So therefore, PILs is not a word which typically a bureaucrat or a technocrat in a municipality or a government will like, because it is seen as an impediment, an obstacle for implementing a development project or a particular service. At the same time, non-governmental agencies and activists and environmental activists are all the time utilizing this particular facility and going to court and showing that how such and such type of actions which are amount to reckless behavior and how it is creating damage to ecosystem or environment. And many excellent laws in this country, as I already told you, have been formulated, and courts have ordered formulation of such laws based on the public interest litigation. So it's a very important feature that we should really pay attention to. For example, one of the things that I kind of am involved with the public interest litigation is the concept of prehabilitation. And there was a project of Mumbai Tarasri Express railway project which was passing through an ecofragile region which is called a Dahanu Taluka, which is in Thane district here. And you have the birds and the fish population and the ecofragility, excellent forests, high quality forests prevalent in Dahanu, which by a notification in early 90s declared it as an ecofragile region, and the Honorable Supreme Court of India ordered that it should be protected. And to protect that, so to speak, a first green authority was established by the country, which is called as Dahanu Taluka Environment Protection Authority. I have a fortune of being associated with that authority as an expert member from 1997 onwards, right from inception, where we have tried to not stop the development. Some of the important projects for national interest we are allowing, but at the same time we are not allowing them at the cost of environment and ecology. And I must tell you frankly that industries as well as government development agencies, highway authorities, they are so cooperative that they are trying to accommodate the requests of NGOs, requests of the authorities to take care of environment and ecology, and that is how we are trying to get development but without having a footprint on ecology and environment. So one of the concepts that was prehabilitation. What is prehabilitation? If at all certain houses will have to be taken out, demolished for the want of establishing the project exactly on the same footprint of land, then that may be allowed, provided rehabilitation resettlement activities are done in a very responsible manner. And what is the newer way of doing it? That before the people's houses are destroyed, they are given alternate location and they are established there, and all their socio-cultural requirements are fulfilled, and then the houses are taken down. So it is not rehabilitation, and sometimes the environmental activists are very unhappy because they think that rehabilitation is not done in a sensitive way. This is a way out, that the project developer takes responsibility of rehabilitating with the help of government and with the under the guidance of government, and the development agency and government works together, and newer areas are given where the people can settle with the help of government, and they will do it before the project starts. So in that sense they are prehabilitated, not rehabilitated, because once their houses are broken they feel very helpless, and then they have to accept, becomes a kind of fait accompli, and they have to accept what they have to accept, what they are given. So that kind of situation is sort of avoided, and that is crux of prehabilitation. And it has become now regional expectation, and many high court, including Supreme Court, is accepting this as a precondition before the project is allowed. So what am I telling you? That it is not only a bird or a biodiversity or a water body or air quality or soil moisture or soil quality or some kind of extinct animal or notified area encroachment. This is not the only thing that you are including in the debate on environment, but you are also incorporating the human condition and human beings as an integral part of the development process. I mentioned to you briefly yesterday that environment impact assessment relation of this country first passed in late 80s, then amended in 1996, where since then it is implemented very seriously. An integral part and a mandatory part of that process today is public interest litigation. You cannot pass a project in this country, give environmental clearance, until the human beings involved in this project, which are called PAPs, project affected persons, the community, the people who will be displaced, their concerns have to be addressed in the process of remodeling the path of the progress and implementation of the project. So this is how idea of better R&R, resettlement and rehabilitation, has to be implemented. So it is very much a part of the environmental discourse now, that how project affected persons are placed with least efforts. The chairman of the authority in which I am working, Dahanu Taluka Environment Protection Authority, which is since 1997, Justice Chandrasekhar Dharmadhikari happens to be the chairman of the authority, and he always insists that we definitely want progress. But we want progress without tears. I think this is the sensibility that we will have to incorporate in every human endeavor, that nobody should oppose any progress, any development, any implementation of technology, any creation of new industries, new roads, new railway lines, new ports. Everything is fine. We need that in 21st century for our progress. But it should not be done at the cost of environment, ecology, and then we feel sorry for ourselves after so many years. And then we feel that it was a mistake that we created. In a sense, we are saying that we would like to do it in a sustainable manner, that the future generations also will have the same share, same opportunity to enjoy the access to that natural resource. So that is the basic concept of sustainable development. So I was telling you about prehabilitation, which is about human beings. Now obviously the logical argument, if you stretch it further, would be, but what about plants, that you are going to cut the trees, what about that? So therefore a concept was evolved. Earlier we were talking about afforestation, right? That you cut the trees and then so many number of trees will be put, and then somebody would say, if you are cutting 100 trees, put 200 trees, 2 times. So it is, no, two times is not going to put 3 times. But still, we have done a detailed search on that authority, and then Dahanu authority said, go for compensatory preforestation. What is compensatory preforestation? That you will put trees, you will plant trees right at the beginning of the project cycle, and in subsequent 5 years, you will demonstrate 95% survival of those trees, and you will incorporate the tribal women, deep rural area persons, the rural NGOs, rural community members, poor people, marginalized people, the farmers without land, people below poverty line, these kinds of people, especially women, you encourage them to be part of the maintenance of this infrastructure and of the newly planted forest, and you put the compound around it, you create a pond there so that water is not a short supply to maintain the forest. And with the help of forest department, you create such kind of forest patches, and you do them even before the project work commences. So you are compensating for the damage, and the damage is 10 times. So if you are cutting 10 trees, you better plant 100 saplings and take care of them for 5 years, make them hardy and put them at right place with the help of experts, and incorporate the community and forest department together, and do it as a joint activity of community and forest department. And then do it on a public land, do it on a khar land, do it on a bad land, do it on a degraded patch, so that the micro environment, the local environment improves, and connect it to the life cycle of the people who are in deep rural areas and tribal areas, so that it is not seen as a some kind of external activity, but very much organic to their community survival and community aspirations. They have always grown with that kind of environment. They will feel very happy to take care of that, and which will also create some green jobs for those people. So that is what, not only prehabilitation, compensatory preforestation also is one of the things that we have done. And I am very happy to report to you that the forest department in state of Maharashtra has done brilliant work. They have installed more than 15 such upavans, such small forest patches, different gas pipeline, so much of power sector related addition Dahanu Taluka, and the highway authority, the railway, freight corridor. Our country has to develop for giving opportunity for the people who are not part of the development process so far. So at the same time, we have to also take care of our environment, and that is very nicely and beautifully done, and the entire leadership is with the forest department of state of Maharashtra, and they have created patches and more than lakh trees, which are not just saplings, but they are trees now, and they are planted, and they are the hardy local varieties, they are medicinal plants, they are extremely important for the life cycle of the tribal areas of that region, and those are the people who are really participating in making this program successful. So there can be very ingenious ways of governance of environment, at the same time upgradation of environment and ecology, and that is what essentially I am trying to bring to your notice. So there are two things: a set of laws and regulations is one thing, but also the community, the country takes responsibility of articulating the whole philosophy, whole commitment, a whole framework for what would we like to achieve and how would we like to achieve. The whole activity is essentially called as policy making. And as opposed to the common misunderstanding that policy is a nicely written 30-40 pages document, that is not the case. Yesterday I showed you a copy of National Environment Policy of 2006, and it is understood now that for example, in our case, India's case, constitution happens to be the basis of policy making. That we know that there are provisions in constitution and there are certain principles which are given in our India's constitution, very squarely, very clearly are stated. For example, in the original constitution, Article 21, of India's original constitution, Dr. Ambedkar has very clearly stated that we have right to live. Now, that right to live is now broadened by the through the case law by the Honorable Supreme Court of India and many other courts, high courts in the state, that the right to live means right to breathe clean air, right to drink clean water, and right to live in an environment so that healthy life can be. So, right to live is right to healthy life. Right to healthy life further goes to the clean environment components such as water, air, and noise free and dust free air and clean water and pollution free environment in general. So, the constitution is the basis for us Indians, that we have a very nicely written constitution, and we are also very careful in amending constitution from time to time, and we are putting more environmental features into our constitution. So, that is our basis. And then there are certain underlying principles which we have to sort of agree upon, and that becomes the basis or foundation for making the policy. For example, sustainability of the actions, both ecological and economic as well as social, which is called triple bottom line in sustainable development. So, ecology, economics and society, all three are taken care, which is the sustainability as underlying principle. Or comprehensive and integrated approach for protection of environment, that you shall not resort to a piecemeal approach, that you do only the patchwork and not do it later, do it here but not do it there. That kind of approach is not appreciated. We have accepted the principle of comprehensive and integral action, and that is what we have done. We shift from curative to preventive approaches. Treatment of pollution is far more expensive. Rather, you invest the similar amount of money into the prevention. And in fact, you can go ahead, and I have observed based on my interaction with several industries that the industry which is not interested in putting 25 lakh rupees for protection of a particular type of water pollution occurring in their industry, but the same industry goes ahead and puts 2.5 crore rupees subsequently in 2 years, because they realize that the COD of wastewater can be minimized if they capture all the solvent. So, then instead of using the water jets, they use the vacuum pumps, they remove the solvent from wastewater, and then slowly they put the solvent back into the process. So, which they were paying 150 rupees, let us say argument's sake, they are putting ethylene dichloride, one solvent, which was also having potential for creating indoor pollution and hazard to the workers, and in some cases solvents, organic solvents are also highly carcinogenic, and they can create very bad health impacts which cannot be reversed. All those benefits are definitely there, but at the same time you are paying 150 rupees or you are paying 250 rupees per liter of that solvent otherwise, which money can be actually saved, and you can recycle the solvent back, and very small fraction of solvent ultimately will end up into the wastewater. So, the loads of pollution in the wastewater treatment plant go down not only by factor of 5, but literally by factor of 50. So, that kind of change can take place, and to be able to achieve that, if you want to put a kind of technology, you want to put low compressor pumps and you want to put some better technology, then so be it. They are willing to put 2.5 crore, because the payback period of that investment is less than 3 years. So, if you are able to really break even, even accounting for the loan that you took on that investment, even that you are able to pay back everything in about 3 years period, then it is worth it in putting technology of that sort. So, therefore, industry will go ahead and put money where they will not be putting 25 lakh rupees just to do a minimum compliance related thing, but if they are getting something back from it and the payback period is reasonable, then they will do it. So, idea is that you shift from curative to preventive, and my experience is that I cannot even name one example where preventive approach has become the problem for finances. It only represented expenditure and no benefit was obtained. It does not happen. Obviously, polluter pays is a very important principle that you would like to sort of incorporate in your policy making, and inter and intra-generational equity, which is heart of the sustainability approach, that is also insisted and that is also incorporated. But friends, just like you have some of the important underlying principles that you agree to incorporate in the policy making exercise, you also will have to have, as I said, underlying principles and commitment. The second box diagram, if you see, the underlying commitments are, for example, socio-economic justice for all. Here I would like to sort of put something to you. So, it is not, the debate is not whether 30 milligram BOD is all right, or should we go for 10, or should we insist for 5, and that is not the issue here. The basic issue is that is our environmental program and is our activity, human activity, leading towards more and more justice and more inclusive growth and opportunity for the people who have stayed outside our economic cycle so far. See, India became independent for not few people becoming rich or only cities becoming more beautiful and livable. The India also lives in her villages, like as we talked yesterday. So we have to keep in mind that there has to be an effort for inclusive growth, and everybody should get equal opportunity. And more importantly, we have to make efforts for giving those people who never got any opportunity for growth so far, and that kind of protective justice will have to be given to them. So the entire discussion about environmental governance and participating environmental protection activity is not for compliance. Please keep this particular point in mind, that entire world is going in the direction of how can we deliver more justice through the plank of environment. Why? Because if you do not have proper environmental conditions, the first person or first individual who gets affected by that is a person below poverty line, a person staying in slum, that too more importantly a woman in the family, because she is finally saddled with the responsibility of go get water, go get fuel, go get twigs for chulla. So that affects the girl children, keep them away from education. So if you really see inequality and the people who have stayed outside the economic cycle in spite of all the efforts of various agencies including government, now time has come that people are saying enough is enough. Now we have to bring them into this thing, and environment is used as a plank for promoting justice. So any discussion, policy making or any activity related to environment are essentially to promote justice. So the commitment is to justice, and commitment is to inclusive growth, and commitment is protection of natural heritage, or commitment is to preservation of intrinsic worth of the nature and society both, and protect biodiversity, and establishment of global convention on environmental regimes and duties. You become, try to become part of the global reality, the global citizenry, that India Vishudeva Kutumbam, the entire world is a village. That is what is philosophy, that all over the world is accepted, including at the Hague, that we are not taking a sectoral approach, we are not taking regional approach, we are not taking a national boundary, as a environment knows no boundary. Air moves freely, water moves freely, pollution moves freely. The two lands are connected by one common ocean. So this is a commons which is owned by everybody. It is a heritage given to us. We are not the owners. So earth stewardship it is called as, that trusteeship as Gandhi would say, that we are trustees, we are not owners. We are the trustees of this nature. So all the birds, all the jungle, this biodiversity, this beautiful morning and evening Gandhi would say, or a beautiful star, starry night, and the entire rain and sun and moon, everything is our heritage. We are trustees of that. And we don't own them, and we should not have exploitative relationship with these things. And that this brings actually to a question that somebody had asked me, K.S. Rangaswamy College of Technology, Namakkal in Tamil Nadu. And the question is there any act available for the exploitation of groundwater? Please forgive me, my friend. I am not putting you on spot, but I somehow don't like the word exploitation. Exploitation is a bad word, in my opinion. We are no business, and we are not responsible for getting benefits from somebody. We have to live together, we have to let other person live, and we have to allow nature to take its own course, and we have to only use the role of catalysis, become a catalyst in the process, and try to do better, more better, with higher speed, that's all. But we are not going to exploit anything. So I'm sorry, we will not exploit groundwater. But we will be responsible users of groundwater. So wherever there is no water available, we will take water from ground. At the same time, we will also give ground opportunity for recharging of water. Just like we take milk from cow every day, but we make sure the bachada, the calf, gets enough milk, isn't it? At the same time, we also make sure that the green fodder and the nutrition and the oily seeds and the dry fodder, everything is given to cow. So exactly our environment is just like that. There is in fact a philosophy called as Gaia philosophy, which James Lovelock, so which we essentially says that this earth is just like a cow, and all the requirements and all the life and all the vital issues related to cow are as much true for the earth as a system. And therefore, the exploitation is not the relationship that we would like to keep in 21st century with environment. We would not exploit groundwater, but we will use groundwater with more responsibility. But don't forget, since you mentioned groundwater, to take out groundwater, you need only a 5 horsepower pump, a submersible pump, and you know, within minutes and seconds, you can really pump out huge quantities of water, depending on how large a pump and how long do you run it. And it doesn't need too much of efforts. But if you want to replenish groundwater through recharge activity, then you have to first make sure that the water source is correct. You have to make sure that the quality is acceptable. If you are trying to take the sewages and the surface runoff and try to recharge them, you have to first stop them somewhere. You have to lift them, treat them, disinfect them, and then you have to recharge. So you have to remove pathogen, you have to remove pollutant, you have to make it cleaner, you have to make it free from particulate matter. Obviously, odor and other chemicals goes without saying, and then you have to recharge. And then you may not be the beneficiary of that activity. Therefore, people are shying away from recharging groundwater because they are not sure that what are the structures inside the ground and whether they will get the water back or they will never get the water back. So you sow the plant, but somebody else, the neighbor, is probably getting the flowers of the plant because branches probably are tilting his compound. So that kind of neighbor getting the flowers can be the activity of groundwater conservation. Therefore, many people run away. But if everybody says the same thing, then we will not have enough groundwater, which in fact is the situation today, that there is over exploitation of groundwater. That's why I am opposing the word exploitation here. So we have to assist environment to preserve water for us in ground. When we have a bad day, when we have a non-rainy year, we should be able to depend on groundwater. And there are certain legislations and even the policies are coming up. National Environment Policy is talking about protection of groundwater and how much can we do, how much we should not do. Many, many municipalities are insisting that farmhouses and other municipal societies do not abstract water from ground and things like that. So the point that I was trying to make was that once you have identified and understood what are the underlying principles and commitments, then you go for development of strategies, development of programs, and then you try to implement them. Am I telling you about policy? Yes, I am telling you about policy. Policy is not only writing on a piece of paper. Policy is also implementing them, then trying to analyze obstacles and drivers of those, then do a midterm assessment of the policy, success and failure, and then honestly you go back and change your strategies, your even principles and commitment, you address them, you create new programs, different programs, if the existing programs are failing. Like for example, JNNURM gave some kind of success to government. Now based on that, the central government has, Minister of Urban Development has gone forward, and now they are talking about 100 smart cities in the country. So they definitely would like to go a step forward, try to incorporate the lessons learned from earlier activity and do it more. So this is the job of the government to give this kind of inputs. And then based on that, again, you change your policy document, you change your regulation, you also bring in the activities such as bringing more funding for that activity, identifying groups to participate. Today, new things are being talked about, like public-private partnership, PPP model. What is that PPP model? Earlier, we used to say everything will be done by government. Municipality will take care. I will create kachara and put it outside my house. Municipality should come and pick it up. Now they are saying that I will pay for my pollution. Therefore, I will create a private agency which will assist the municipality to do its function. If you take analog of solid waste management, municipal solid waste management, same thing can be done with wastewater. Same thing can be done with industrial wastewater through CETP, or same thing can be done for air pollution control. So everywhere you are trying to incorporate a private partner, a private funding, make protection of environment as a business by itself and give a bankable solution to the problem. This is the direction in which people are going, and this whole exercise is essentially the policy making. That I will make it bankable, that I will make that somebody will pay for it, that I will make sure that government will encourage it, that I will make sure that the private partners' commercial interest will be protected to a reasonable extent so that nobody is greedy, at the same time nobody loses money in spite of investing capital in the business. So that this is a balancing act, and policy is not just a proclamation of philosophy, but is a very much practical thing that we are going to talk about. Now we are moving in last 10-12 minutes, we are wrapping up what we have learned so far and trying to put in front of you a few concepts that finally we take away as lessons. Before I completely close the thing, I am just trying to show you some of the case study related photographs so that you get a flavor of why we are doing it, how we can do it, what is the role of science and technology, what is the role of civic society, how can we have a partnership with government, how can community government work together, how can private industry government can work together. These are all elements of the development process, and until we really do it in a responsible manner, those who have stayed outside the circle of progress so far will not be brought into the circle. And inclusive growth, the number one motto of today's development paradigm. Now you are looking at Alang. Alang is a place near Bhavnagar, and Bhavnagar is a place near to coast in Gujarat, and there they have ship breaking industry, and you are looking at, enough can be said about ship breaking industry by itself, but I am just trying to show you this is an activity. You can say this as a chaos, you can say this is an environmental disaster, this is one way of looking at it. Other thing is that somebody is breaking a ship which otherwise olden days the government used to sink them in middle of ocean, or people did not know what to do with them, and therefore they used to become environmental hazard and risk. Now today somebody is breaking them in a very ingenious manner and trying to get steel and non-ferrous metal and so many reusable objects and engines and so many parts that can be refurbished and put back into economy. So it is in a way a preventive strategy, that instead of polluting the ocean, it is a preventive strategy. One of the paints that is used for outside the ship surface, which is called a ship hull, contains a tin, tributyl tin is there in that. You should not be surprised, both the oceans, the large oceans in this world, are contaminated to the extent that is a measurable concentration of tin now in our oceans today, and which is largely, the one of the suspicion is that largely it is coming because of the paints that are using the heavy concentration, high concentration of these toxic metals. Ocean bed is having shells which has very high concentration of these toxic metals. So we should try to utilize our technological sense and our management skill and apply the responsible sustainable development related eco-friendly regime, let this sector do more preventive approach to not wasting the resources, at the same time preventive approach for not contaminating the ocean. So I am just trying to show you this sector is one of the focus areas in some of the research going on in IIT Bombay. Somebody has asked what are the type of things that you do, therefore I am bringing to you some case studies where you will understand that what all we talked about has a technology, science component, technology component, biodiversity component, sustainability component, legal component, regulation component, policy component. All these components are actually implemented here, and since we have few minutes to cover this, please forgive me for not going into deep, but I hope there is another opportunity for you that we are not only working in the workplace, but also talking to the people who are responsible for operating the workplace. The production managers, the environment managers, the foremen, and we are talking to them, we are trying to understand how exactly are they protecting, what are the measures that they are using, and is it concurrent with the national environmental policy. The same thing can be done, same approach can be applied to even looking at appropriate wastewater treatment technology using different tools. For example, in this case I am saying life cycle assessment and so many other tools where you are looking at life cycle costing, multi-attribute decision making activity, or incorporating newer methods of ranking the alternatives, where you are incorporating the questions such as global warming potential, such as biodiversity loss, or such as impact on community, or such as long term, long range bad impacts of the actions, that you take incorporate into your decision making. And this is one of the very much policy making related actions, that you incorporate these concerns with the help of a detailed mathematical managerial tool, and then you try to revisit your regulation activity. And this is one thing that we have, for example, as I told you, eutrophication, life cycle costs, land requirements, manpower requirements are incorporated as the robustness of the system in terms of reliability, durability, flexibility, and obviously the sustainability as a ruler, that acceptability, participation, replicability, or promotion of sustainable behavior. These are the kinds of things that we are trying to incorporate in case study. The other sector, for example, that we have been studying in IIT Bombay, other than myself, there are 9 other people. We are 10 people teaching at Center for environmental science and engineering in IIT Bombay. And this is more than 35 years old center in operation, one of the early ones in the country. And different colleagues are concentrating on different areas of their specific interest. And I am simply showing you some things that we have been doing more enthusiastically. For example, earlier planning commission, Dr. Montek Singh Ahluwalia, and the environment resources energy person, Dr. K. Kasturi Rangan, earlier chief of ISRO. Two people were responsible from planning commission in creating a task force was created by the Prime Minister's office for integrated municipal solid waste management and waste to energy practices in the country. And we studied various aspects of this problem. Last year, after new government took over, the final report was available to the new government, which they wholeheartedly accepted and implemented to create a new CPHU guidelines for municipal solid waste management. And based on that, the municipal solid waste management and handling rules of 2008 are further modified in 2015, and the new draft is now available for you. So the basis of that was this particular report that was also prepared. Again, there is a, it's a policy making exercise, how science and technology can help solving a particular problem. You have rejuvenation of lakes and rivers using decentralized natural treatment system. This is a very large field, a lot of things can be said, but we are doing constructed wetland based waste research in IIT. I do not want to take too much of time on this, only to say that the work started in a gamla, in a potted plant. And then obviously with different vegetation, and a research station was finally established on IIT Bombay campus, where we have this kind of constructed wetland which is in place now, which is taking a small flow from a pumping station, whole sewage, and now treating it, and we are having getting fantastic results on it. So idea is that how can we use a low cost technology which is using the natural principle, and how can we give that benefit to small communities to treat their waste. In fact, this approach was used in a large way for rejuvenation of Mansagar Lake in Jaipur. This project was done under supervision of Professor Soli Arsiwala, who is a well-known environmental expert of our country. I am sure many of you would be familiar with his name. Professor Arsiwala's supervision essentially directed us to use the natural treatment system for rejuvenation of the lake. And this Mansagar was like a cesspool of wastewater, and only mud, kachra and sewage water was around, and Mansagar was such a bad and dirty and broken down condition, it was almost a khandahar, and today this is the situation. And why I am bringing your attention to this project, because we have a public-private partnership, 80 crore rupees have been spent, and government did not even have to spend 10% money on this, entire money came from the private party. And then it was looking like this when we entered in 2003, now it is looking like this today. So if you really see, it was looking like this in 2002, 2003, when initially we went, there were crores of mosquitoes per person if anybody visited that site, and today you have, this is the situation. Some artist developed his photo album by taking the old photos from our record and putting the tripod exactly in the same place that he imagined where the picture must have taken, and taken the identical photo. Therefore, you have 23 species of birds now staying because the lake is rejuvenated. Why I am telling you? Because it is rejuvenated using the constructed wetland as a technology. 7.8 MLD, largest plant of the country, is there. 7.8 MLD wastewater is treated every day and put. We are making humble effort now. Just we have started the work, rejuvenation of Pavai Lake, using the same policy that we use for Mansagar Lake. It took 8 years for us to work together, and 7 agencies including state government and central government worked together, and then we could make that project successful. Similar effort now, Mumbai Municipal Corporation is taking a lot of efforts and really want to solve this problem. The whole idea is that using the water as a theme for social change, and I am going to close my discussion with this particular view graph. That ultimately what we want to achieve is social engineering. Look, nobody really worry about 30 milligram BOD or 100 milligram COD as a number per se, but finally they would like to get a particular social benefit. And then we have a water as a theme. The Rajiv Gandhi Foundation has given us money to use this as a business model and implement this constructed wetland technology, which we have already demonstrated on IIT Bombay campus and in Mansagar in Jaipur. we are taking this technology and we are implementing it in three small villages around Masward, which is called as Man Taluka, which is a dry taluka in district of Satara, about 400 kilometers away from Mumbai and land regions of western Maharashtra. And the IIT Bombay is partnered by the Mandeshi Mahila Foundation there, who are essentially implementing that. And a Section 25 trust-like company is implementing this project with the help of women who are below poverty line and landless laborers. They are implementing this technology in this world. So we are utilizing a technology for benefit of people, and water theme becomes the theme for development progress, for inclusive growth. This is essentially the true environmental action, that you are stopping pollution of river on one hand by intercepting sewage and treating it and utilizing that water for making cows drink that water and use the fodder for cows and get the milk from cows or get the goats, sell them in market and then get the money. That surplus essentially helps that those women to teach computers, teach skills to other women, other young girls, help send the girls to school. So all this, this cycle is complete. So you cannot see environment in isolation with the other societal challenges, and we really connect it together. The policy making will remain only the exercise of word processing. Musi River case study of NGRI, which is a CSIR laboratory at IIT Bombay collaboration in government of Telangana near Hyderabad, the natural wetland is upgraded using the constructed wetland. That project already has started. And then near Mumbai, small city there, Panvel, the new airport, you must have heard the name in that connection, that new international airport is being built near Panvel. So there is another 8 kilometers from Panvel, we have a Shantivan, one of the first early leprosy homes built by Mahatma Gandhi. So it is a leprosy hospital and home, and 240 bedded girls hostel for tribal girls, and 200 boys hostel, and a high school of 500 students. That community generates a huge amount of sewage which we are trying to recycle and give them for their garden. So friends, this is the way we are seeing that we will convert the activity of treatment of wastewater into a more community activity, where animals also will be part of that ecosystem, and there will be a village pond. That village pond will collect water which can be used for irrigation and so many other gainful activities. You can even have a recreation place for the village, which most of the villages do not have nowadays in our country. So you can actually increase the quality of life for people if you try to use environment as a plank for achieving inclusive growth. And policy making is exactly aiming at that. It is not at the indicators of pollution, but the indicators of the growth and better human condition in the society. That is the overall objective of policy making. Thank you so much.